Hello, YouTube. Mr. Castle here, and welcome to Tower of God Episode 6 Review, Position Selection. We have quite a bit to talk about today because, let's be real, we're talking about Tower of God here, and if you know anything about Tower of God pertaining to the webtoon, there is massive world building ahead. So first things first, who in the hell does this bimbo think she is? She first abandons him never to return, then she acts like he doesn't even exist, now she's telling Kuna to lie on her behalf. What the f- Also going forward, is Rachel's new team just gonna chill on this floor with Bam and everyone now? Won't that be kind of weird since Kun told Bam that the woman he thought was Rachel really isn't Rachel, so now you're just going to have Bam staring creepily in the distance at Rachel? He's gonna be like, hey girl, you really look like someone I know. I don't really know how the anime will tell the story going forward with them being on the same floor still, but Rachel seems to be broken up by this fact. Hey now, I know we have to social distance now, but at least Rat cleans up after himself. Also, we can't forget the most important part of the episode, which is who the hell took all of Rack's chocolate bars? We already know the answer to that question. With that being said, Rack is by far my favorite character of the show thus far. Speaking of different characters in this anime, it is a little weird to me because usually I am more intrigued about the main protagonist of a show I enjoy, but in this case all we have is Bam, who was found and raised by Rachel as a kid, and apparently he's like some super strong monster. This is completely fine because we have a lot of other character development, which just seems to happen every single episode. Now, is it just me or is the pacing of this show super fast? I'm really enjoying the show thus far, and it has a decent amount of laughs and also unanswered questions, which is good because it keeps me interested into putting all the pieces together as the show progresses. Moving forward, can anyone tell me what the hell is this thing? I really like the sequence of the big snake as the administrator, which makes me wonder, is the administrator someone that they can meet later on? Is he part of the tower? Or maybe he's just some corporate executive of the tower just doing his job. What really struck me is that he said to Bam, for you, this isn't a contract, it's a shackle. Which makes me think that maybe his full potential will be limited by this contract. Or this could be something he says to everyone, but I doubt the story would want us to simply believe that.
Of course!
What was up with Rachel's dream, by the way? That's another thing I think they added in there to intrigue us into speculating what this is that could have met. But to me, I kept thinking, this is your comeuppance, woman. After what you did to poor Bam, now he's just gonna leave your butt behind. I don't necessarily think this, but I do think that it portrays him almost as a leader of sorts, or someone who is powerful and will be respected by many in the future. But with Rachel, I won't be so quick to judge because I feel they are building this character up to have a deep backstory to why it is she wants to see the damn stars so badly. So we come to find that Endorsi is a princess of Jihad as well, which how many freaking princesses of Jihad are there? We come to find that maybe even Rachel might be a princess of Jihad, question mark? I did like how we finally got some confirmation of how the princesses of Jihad works. Endorsi explains that they are basically like brand name shoes put on display in Jihad Showcase, which must mean they all must be capable fighters from the extent of the princesses we have met thus far. I just like how Endorsi goes from this crazed killer in the last episode to this chill girl who's just hanging out with everyone. So as of right now, for me, she is my number one waifu in the show. Is it me or is this show just getting weirder? I guess weird is good because a change up keeps things fresh. I like the fact that they introduced fighting positions, which kind of reminds me of like a specific fighting class in a video game. Not gonna lie, I'm starting to get some Black Clover vibes. The way they are building this anime makes me feel like the people that survive the first few tests will be all forced to work together in the future, so maybe that is why they are teaching them about different positions on the battlefield so they can work together and climb the higher floors. This whole show just opens up a huge amount of possibilities, and I'm super intrigued to see where they go next with it. The last part of the episode, we come to find some pretty revealing information about Anak Jihad and who she really is. Kun comes to find that Anak Jihad is already dead, so who could this person with the sword Green April be? She is none other than the daughter of Anak Jihad, who was orphaned at a young age because her mom was killed by other princesses of Jihad. It also goes on about how her mom was married to a chef that could make the best chicken pies in the world. So why the heck did the princesses kill him? No wonder Anak is so pissed, she just wanted her chicken pot pies. Anyway, she is on a quest for revenge to kill anyone named Jihad to achieve her revenge, which I thought was a great way for the episode to end. So again, with another episode down, we learned overall about the story, but we still have many unanswered questions. If you are indeed enjoying this anime, let me know down in the comments and your predictions to whether or not we'll kill Dorsey this coming episode. Be sure to subscribe, hit the notification bell for more additional content on Tower of God, and I will be posting a weekly review for every episode to come out. Again, this is Mista Kassla, and thanks for watching. Bye-bye.